I'm Dave Nelson, and joining me on the host panel this week is Brad Ludwig, Anessa Moyens, and JF Dubow. Welcome back, guys.
Woo!
Yay!
And especially Anessa. Anessa, it's been a while since you've been on the Sci-Fi Geeks Club.
Yeah, because I think the last time I podcasted, the Sci-Fi Geeks Club didn't afterwards.
Oh. Oh, it must have been a week when we just did the alien invasion, right?
Yeah. And then I had to be out for a couple of weeks.
Okay. Well, welcome back. Good to have you again. Filling in for Matt Stein this week is a semi-regular on the show. It is JF Dubow. JF, how are you?
I'm doing good. Exhausted, as always, but that's kind of my MO.
When you think JF, you think tiredness.
Well, you know. I overcommit and promise things to people that I then can't deliver, and so I have to sacrifice things like sleep to get stuff done.
By the way, you haven't been on since you met your since the victory of the Inkshares campaign. So you want to just do a quick review of what happened, like within a few sentences of what explain
well,
what happened?
as much as I love to talk about myself, I have been on since that happened. We're the episode of TJ Boat, and we talked about that at length.
Oh, Jesus. Holy crap. Okay, sorry. My stupid brain. I forget things.
It's fine. It's cool. I mean, you do what? 12? 13 shows?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah. Yeah, you're right.
He's the hardest working man in podcast business.
No. There's people a lot busier than I am as far as that goes. But, JF, thank you for filling in for Matt this week. Let's bring our guest on. He is a... our guest geek this week is, of course, the Game Master for the Critical Hit podcast and a panelist on the Major Spoilers and Top 5 podcasts on the Major Spoilers Network. Welcome to the Sci-Fi Geeks Club, Rodrigo Lopez. Rodrigo, welcome. Not much. You know what? You deserve a little fanfare, and here it is. How does that make you? Does that make you feel warm and welcome?
But we can't afford much, so we got a little band together to do that one piece.
That's all right. So what's been going on with you lately with Major Spoilers? It's not Major Foilers. That's some other
foils again.
Major Spoilers, Critical Hit, and Top 5. What's going on with those lately?
Nice.
You know my favorite part of that podcast is the way that Steven describes it on each episode at the top, because it's always different. Yeah, that's my favorite part. By the way, speaking of Critical Hit, you know, we've got a gaming podcast of our own, and maybe Brad and you should talk about you coming on his podcast. It's called Adventure Party. I almost said Adventure Time, Brad. I'm sorry. Adventure.
Well, we don't have weird dogs, talking dogs, and vampires that appear on our show that we know of, but Adventure Party
seems to work for them.
We'll do anything once. We don't care. No, Adventure Party is where we talk about RPGs, board games, and we try to get a guest on that has something to say about a topic that we pick. And this upcoming show that we're going to be doing, we're going to be talking about miniatures, painting miniatures, and
probably... Oh, I know a guy.
Yes. Yes, you do, JF.
Oh, and, I forgot this week. That's right.
Yeah. So JF is the guest, and we're JF, myself, and Glenn have all painted miniatures. I have a feeling that JF has probably painted a lot more than we have, but we all have experience, we all have techniques, and we're going to just talk about it a little bit. So there you go. Boom.
You're going to talk a little bit, but as most people know me might be aware of, I'm going to talk a lot, even when the microphones are turned off. I don't shut up.
See, the interviews are typically like 35 to 45 minutes, and all I'm going to say to start it out is, hey, JF, do you paint miniatures? And I'm just going to let it go. And when we hit the 45-minute mark, then we'll just we'll call it a wrap.
That's the great thing about JF. You know, whenever I'm tired and really don't want to really talk much during the podcast, I invite him on, and that way I just sit back and just
see,
let it go.
Now we're making him feel bad. Let's not do that.
No. I know where I stand. I'm there to bring the quantity as opposed to the quality.
You bring both.
You bring both, JF. We tease because we love JF.
Oh, thank you. But this isn't about me. This is about our guest.
Absolutely.
Yeah, Rodrigo, welcome. And you'll fit right in. Let's start with the news. Chris Pratt and Jennifer Lawrence sci-fi flick. I almost said Lopez, maybe because that's Rodrigo's last name. their sci-fi flick, Passengers, gaining momentum. Apparently, Sony wasn't sure about this movie because it had a high budget, but then Guardians of the Galaxy happened, and a little movie called Lost World happened as well, so they're feeling more confident, and now they have their full Sony force behind this movie. So they have trust in the Chris Pratt and the Jennifer Lawrence. I think they could bring in some people. I think they can fill some seats in this movie. So the plot of Passengers revolves around an interstellar spaceship carrying thousands of colonists en route to a distant solar system when one of the passengers, Chris Pratt, is awoken 90 years too early. With no way to regain cryogenic sleep, he decides to revive another passenger, Jennifer Lawrence, to help pass away the slow trip into old age. So I hear this.
Good choice, Chris Pratt. I mean, if you have to pick.
Well, I'm sure that he could see inside
I was thinking of personalities. No, don't be superficial.
Oh, well. Personality. Oh, okay.
No, but
there it is.
I'm stepping on everyone's toes tonight. I'm sorry. I just wanted to say that I'm kind of surprised and a bit delighted that Sony hesitated, because with those two names attached, you'd think they'd jump on any dumb project. And the fact that they're sort of pussyfooting around it, waited to make sure that everything would work out with other properties that Chris Pratt was on, shows a level of being careful and not following trends that's kind of unusual for Sony.
I think maybe they learned their lesson from all that's happened the last year or so with the leak and movies just bombing. Amazing Spider-Man 2. So I think they want to try new things, and this sounds like a fresh property, and it sounds like an interesting story, although it sounds like something that's been done before.
Really?
Yeah. There's a TV show, and I forget the name of it, but it's supposed to be on Sci-Fi, I believe, where this is, no, was it, I'm trying to remember the name of that, the TV show that's supposed to be premiering on, I don't know when, on Sci-Fi, but it's got a similar plot to this, where it's not just one person wakes up, but it's like the entire ship wakes up way too early. I wish I could remember it, but I can't. But it's a very similar plot to this.
Doesn't ring a bell, but I can see this being a slightly more complex, very gravity-like sort of interaction between the characters. I mean, you can imagine that Pratt makes his choice, wakes up the second passenger, probably doesn't tell her he's doomed her to die alone with him.
Yeah.
Until eventually she probably finds out, and then things slowly go to hell. So either they kill each other, she kills him, or they find a way to go back to cryosleep, having dealt with their problems. But I can see a lot of complex interpersonal drama in this movie. except with a lot less comedy. There's a lot we don't know that could be very interesting. Like, it's supposed to be high budget, so I guess you're probably right that there's going to be a lot of green screen and special effects, but the way the synopsis is written, this could have been a very low budget movie with just very few scenes, very few sets, I mean.
I hope that Jennifer Lawrence's character junk punches Chris Pratt's character. You woke me up for this?
No, just you're... saying. JF, you're right about pretty much knowing the plot of this movie before it's even made. Like, you know the plot points. You know what's going to happen before it even...
I mean, both Rodrigo and I have... Like, he says more romantic comedy and they settle their differences. I mean, I can imagine, especially with the idea of special effects, that they're not necessarily going to get along and there might be... I mean, there's probably going to be more drama and... violence even that's going to justify the special effects. You know, maybe they're going to break important things and need to repair them, and I can see this movie ending with Chris Pratt sacrificing himself to save Jennifer Lawrence and the ship, because like sort of a redemption story for his assholery. There's a lot of different ways this could, different directions that this could go that might be awesome or super cliche, and I'm eager to see trailers and more about this.
Yeah, I think we'll have to wait a couple of years though.
Yeah, because I mean we've got nothing to work on, but it's an interesting premise. I like the idea of them going dark, going dramatic, and doing like a Gravity type thing.
All right, let's move on to the second story. Star Wars Rogue One casts an Oscar winner. Although it's not for sure yet, Variety reports that Forrest Whitaker is in negotiations to join the cast of director Gareth Edwards' upcoming standalone film set in a galaxy far, far away. No word yet on what he'll be playing. Disney and Lucasfilm have yet to comment. Rogue One will take place between the events of episodes 2 and... Wait a second. 2 and 4? Why does it say 2? Yeah, I think you're right. Yeah, episode 3 and 4. But will be closer to Star Wars A New Hope time-wise. It will be released in theaters December 16th, 2016. Are you guys excited to have Forrest Whitaker on board for this film?
Yes.
That's all you got? A yes?
I don't have a horse in this race. I mean, I like Forrest Whitaker. But we've seen brilliant actors put in the Star Wars franchise and not be able to do much. I'm super excited for this. I'm super excited for Rogue One, for Episode 7, and everything that's going to come. Like, I'm hyper optimistic, but I'm hesitant to throw out definitive opinions until we see what the tone's going to be. Like, once Episode 7's out and we have a better footing as to the direction this is all going, then I'll be able to jump off the walls about all the side projects.
But really, I mean, Episode 7 and this movie probably have nothing to do with each other because it takes place before Episode 4. So,
story-wise, I agree, but it's going to give us an idea of the overarching direction that Disney is going to give to their directors as to the tone that they want. And how much they're going to hold them, you know, to what standards of quality.
So what do we know about Gareth Edwards? He did Godzilla, right?
Yes.
Sounds
I can't remember. I'm
right.
Terrible with names.
Me too.
Rodrigo, do you know?
Yeah, okay. He did Godzilla, Monsters, Shadow of the Moon.
Oh, Monsters, that's right. I love Monsters.
I do too.
Have you guys seen the latest Godzilla, the one that came out last year?
Yes. I have not.
I really want to, though.
Is it any good?
It has a lot of... There are a couple of nods to, you know, earlier Godzilla films. There's a mention of Mothra, which is kind of brief and a little funny. I don't know, the tone and the amount of realism that they add to it is not like the original Godzilla, you know, the rubber suit type movies.
I have seen it. Sorry.
There you go. It has a very gritty realism to it. Very interesting take on Godzilla's purpose on Earth. So it was kind of a slightly fresh approach, definitely Americanized version of Godzilla.
Getting back to Rohan, what character do you think Forrest Whitaker could be playing in this? Like, do you think he's more of a Empire person, or do you think he's more of a rebel type person?
Yeah.
Yeah. He's got such a soft voice. I really can't see him being part of being the imperial, an imperial leader of any kind.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. I'll take your word for it.
I give you Alan Rickman in Die Hard.
Oh yeah.
Not very shouty, but when he talks, he gets your attention. See. Oh yeah.
Yeah, good point.
Except for in Fifth Element. That was
not yeah.
Touché. That's true.
It's that crazy.
Yeah.
Because his character's nuts, right? I mean, you know a person's crazy when they go from very manic that way. All right, well, we'll see. I guess as time goes by, more of this news on this will come out. Forthcoming Discworld novel will be the last in Terry Pratchett's beloved series. The author's daughter, Rhianna, has announced that the book titled Shepherd's Crown, which was pretty much complete at Pratchett's passing, will be the last official entry in the series. She says she does not intend to continue it herself because she is a pretty damn fine writer in her own right, or allow any other writers to add installments to the official canon, although she will be kind of the keeper of the store as far as this goes, because she is open to kind of being the watchful eye over like spin-offs or video games, things like that, to make sure that her father's legacy isn't affected. Show of hands, who has read the Discworld books here?
I think I read the first two.
I mean, say something, because it's an audio thing. What?
I think I've read the first two.
Okay.
I've not read any.
Okay.
I'm going to be as boring as everyone else. I've started reading... I have a strange relationship where every time I tried to read Terry Pratchett was when I was not in the mood for humor and randomly picked up some of his more whimsical book, and that I just didn't finish the books, so I never really picked up any Discworld.
I think I read one of them when I was like a kid, like when I was in high school, but I don't remember. It's been so long. I'm 48, for God's sakes.
Yeah, I have. I think the first of the Discworld series on my Kindle, but I've not gotten around to reading it yet.
I'm thinking that
I own like three Terry Pratchett books. I think one of them is a Discworld book, but I know I have the Weird Sisters. But every time I've tried to read them, it just seems too whimsical for my taste. I'm gonna have to give it another shot.
Maybe it'd be a good.
Have to be in the mood for it.
Maybe he'd be good for like an audiobook.
Maybe. You might have a point.
Yeah.
The books are very tongue in cheek. So I mean, if you're not into the tongue in cheek, it's probably not for you.
I am. Would you? But I don't know. I'm more Douglas Adams than Terry Pratchett, I guess.
Yeah. Well, Douglas Adams is drier.
Yeah.
A drier form of tongue in cheek. As opposed to
is Terry Pratchett kind of silly?
Yeah. Well, based on his books, yes. He had a great sense of humor. One really good book is a team up that he did with Neil Gaiman.
Good Omens.
Called Good Omens, which I highly recommend. I own it here. If you haven't had a chance, you definitely read it.
I adore Neil Gaiman, so maybe that should be my entry point to reading Pratchett.
Yeah, because the two blend their writing styles together to make that book, and it is wonderful, and it really feels like if you've read Dirk Gently's Holistic Detective Agency, it has that kind of a feel to it. There's a lot of different events that happen. All of them are related, but they really don't seem related until you get towards the end of the book and you go, oh. So.
How many, do you guys know how many different Discworld books there has been so far? Anybody have a number? This is probably something that I should
I don't know.
Let's see.
Okay. Well, we can swing back around if somebody wants to look that up. But people were really hoping that his daughter or somebody would take up the mantle and continue the series. But sadly, that's not going to happen. But who knows? She left the door open for spin-offs and that kind of thing. So maybe that. Something like that will happen. Something in that universe will be made in the future sometime.
The Shepherd's Crown will be the 41st book in this series.
Holy crap, really? Oh my god. I was not prepared for that kind of number.
Surprise!
Jesus, okay.
I do have a comment on the whole idea. Like, I haven't really kept my ear to the to what the internet's pulse is on this, but I can understand people hoping that his daughter would maybe continue writing in that universe. But at the same time, if she's an accomplished writer of her own, it feels a bit unfair to put that kind of pressure, since I'm going to assume if she's a writer, she's got her own stories that she wants to tell. Anyway, yeah. I can't imagine that kind of pressure that would put on someone. And in a way, it's laudable that she doesn't just, you know, take the easy money train and, you know, takes the harder road of actually, you know, refusing to do that and doing her own stuff. So now, I'm not pointing fingers, but Frank Herbert, his son, picked up the mantle. I don't know how well received his books were, but it's a lot easier to grab an established, popular, iconic universe and run with that than to just, you know, build your own empire.
And I think Terry Pratchett would be fine letting it go. You know?
There's 41 books!
That's pretty...
Don't really need any more!
Yeah, I think at that point... he would have been willing to let that go, and there's no way he would have said to her, "Hey, continue on for me, please." That's not Terry Pratchett.
So okay.
I don't know to Mad, but oh, go ahead.
I was gonna say, so this new one, is that gonna be 41 or 42?
This will be the 41st.
Okay, because one more, it'd be that's 42,
Douglas
right?
Edwards. Sorry.
Yeah, I know, but still, it'd be kind of cool. JF.
And you have that 42nd book be a crossover.
Yes.
Boom, there you go.
To another deceased author. Yes, we should totally do that.
Come on, zombie all apocalypse. Right.
Woo!
Let's move on to from books to the video games, the Vidya games, as some people say. New Doom and Fallout 4 dates announced at E3. Well, at least the Fallout 4 was the date for that was released. Doom's coming out next spring. Are you guys excited about this? I know everybody's playing Fallout Shelter right now, which is the associated game for Fallout 4.
I've not played Doom, but I've played a bit of Fallout 3, and I really enjoyed it. So I would be looking, you know, I'd be interested in giving Fallout 4 a shot. I haven't played any earlier incarnations, though, of Fallout.
I started downloading Fallout Shelter, and someone says, "You're going to love it. It's like Tiny Towers." And I pressed cancel because when I had Tiny Towers a few years back, I played way too much and got my tower to like 110 stories high, and I had everything, and I insist on not spending money, so I don't have time for Fallout Shelter. So,
but your partner on your Overcast podcast is playing it, Amy Frost. You should be playing it too.
Good for her. I'm enjoying it, but look, I've already fallen down the Heroes of the Storm rabbit hole. I'm thankfully not. I don't know anything about Fallout, so I don't have that kind of nostalgia attachment to the franchise. So I can stay away. I can keep control over this and not get Fallout Shelter.
Rodrigo, are you a Fallout person?
What's up with all these bottle caps? Why are there giant cockroaches?
Who cleans this up?
Who's this weird mutant person going, "I did it again," or like, "I win again"?
That's funny. It's funny to think about. Maybe this time it can actually do the game, right? All right.
Well, and I understand.
The story was crap, but the dwarf was hilarious.
Any other news out of E3 that you guys heard this week that you're kind of pique your interest at all?
Oh my God, yes. Everybody else go first.
I haven't kept up with E3 this year.
There's one thing that absolutely freaking grabbed me. I'm going to have to buy a console now.
What's that?
The Final Fantasy thing on PS4?
I got nothing in this fight. You guys are I got a feeling that I'm the only one not really that interested in what was announced this week. So go ahead.
Go ahead, Rodrigo. Oh, Cuphead. Yep. That whole return to the 30s animation aesthetic is beautiful. Sure.
That did look interesting. Kind of a puzzler. And it looks absolutely gorgeous. Like it's pure eye candy.
All right. Cool. I'm hoping that our friend Ryan Murphy will have more in the Galactic Gaming Netbite here this week as well. If you want.
I do.
Oh, I forgot, JF. Sorry. I wasn't doing that on purpose.
Yeah, because I am super freaking excited about this. I have no basis. It might turn out to be garbage, but it just hit every nail on the head for me. This game, there was a trailer for it. It's called Horizon Zero Dawn. And I'm going to spoil the trailer, but like if you want to get kind of the cool shock of it, pause here and go watch it. It's essentially you get this, it starts with like these tribal people and like cave painting and very Turok type look. And then on one of the paintings, you see it, there's like a modern city with skyscrapers. Oh, it's post-apocalyptic, et cetera, and they talk about like before there were cities. It's very cliche at that point. Still beautiful graphics, but you know, you've got your normal, like we had a civilization, it went poop, and now there's like it's been retaken by nature and we're all savages again. And then it goes back to the gameplay of it, where you play this female character. It looks a lot like Ygritte in Game of Thrones, you know, rough red hair, like very, very barbarian looking, very rough and tumble. And she's got this bow and all this gear on her. And she goes hunting, and then you realize that the animals that she's hunting are giant freaking robots. And that just takes a left turn from there. And she starts hunting these sort of grazing robots with canisters on them, probably filled with plants and nutrients, that she's killing those robots to get those nutrients. And then this giant robot T-Rex shows up and she fights it. And it's all about like the fight. She knocks off pieces of the robot to use against it, and then uses ropes to tie it down so she can have access. Very kind of very Shadow of the Colossus, in the sense that it's all about fighting the creature in a certain sequence to be able to have access to a weak point and then hit that weak point and whatever and win. But I have a thing for robots. Read that as you may. And the idea, first of all, it's supposed to be a very sandbox game. The idea of a gorgeous post-apocalyptic waste, not wasteland, because it's very lush, a lot of plants and forests, but this gorgeous post-apocalyptic cities and forests with giant robots that you have to hunt like they're animals, but using primitive technology to do so, I'm going to have to buy a PS4 and take a month off of life to play that because it looks absolutely gorgeous. I'm really excited.
All right.
Yeah. Yep. I know our PlayStation 3 died months ago, and we've been kind of going back and forth. Well, do we get a refurbished PS3? Do we take the plunge and spend an ungodly amount of money and get a PS4? Yeah. So, I don't know. I think we're getting closer to having to get the PS4.
It's sad because I'm going to buy a PS4 and that game, and that's going to be my PS4 experience. So, I'm looking at a $600 game.
Well, remember, it also works as a Blu-ray player.
Exactly.
Whatever.
I assume it does streaming as the PS3 did, so you could do like Netflix. It's just a really expensive like
Apple TV and Google Dongle thing. I really don't need a PS4 except for that one game, and I'm buying it because it looks awesome.
We're trying to help you justify it, JF.
It looks awesome.
Sorry, we're getting like major echo. Okay, so here's what you do. You are an author, yes? Okay, you are an author, yes? So here's what you do is you buy the PS4, and when you do your taxes, you write it off because you are getting a game, you're doing research, you're doing things about robots. So you can write it off.
I'll give it a shot.
There you go.
So, yeah, all right. You guys ready? All right. So can we move on to something else? Like Spider-Man, perhaps?
Spider-Man, right. Yes.
Yeah, there's apparently still two actors. Sony likes one, Marvel likes the other, and they can't figure out a way to meet in the middle. So... we might have to wait a little bit more time before they make a final decision on what actor is going to play Spider-Man in the combined MCU / Sony universe.
You mean next week? Yes, it will happen next week. That is the latest update.
You've heard that it will definitely be this week that they announce that?
Yes.
Okay. So the actors that they're looking at are both very, very young. And are you guys happy with the way they're doing that, with starting very young? Yeah, yeah, that's true. Now, a question I have is that just a recent thing, like since the Ultimate Universe, that Peter Parker is very young, or was Peter Parker originally supposed to be very young and then went through high school as Spider-Man?
Yep.
Okay.
And actually, right now in the Ultimate Universe. Sorry, we must have like weird.
No, go ahead. Go ahead, Brad.
In the Ultimate Universe, well, at least until they pull the plug on it here, he's a young African American male. So.
Well, that's what's his name?
Miles Morales.
Miles. I knew it was Morales. I couldn't remember his first name.
Mm-hmm. But again, they went young. Okay. So that seems to be the common thread.
Well, so Spider-Man, like, isn't there supposed to be some kind of analogy to puberty and becoming an adult about his storyline? So
it's really
hard to do with a guy in his mid-30s.
Yeah, and the same is for The Incredible Hulk, too.
It's a good line. I think what bothers me the most about this news item, though, is, and this is something that I've had to deal with jobs, which is why it annoys me, is when people aren't minding their own goddamn business. In the sense that if they're making this movie, normally they've hired a director and a casting director, and picking who's going to play Spider-Man should kind of be their decision. So having the studios squabble over that must be so irritating to the people whose actual job it is to make those decisions. And I can imagine the casting director really wanting to commit murders.
Yeah, I think that might have been part of the agreement with Sony, is that they have a say in what happens because they still own the property. So
that doesn't make it any less stupid. I mean,
well,
let's say you hire a guy to redo your roof. You don't just stand over his head and say, "Oh no, no, you shouldn't do it like that." No.
Yeah, that level of micromanagement has been Sony's problem all along.
It's gonna hurt them in the long run because that's the kind of bullshit that they're gonna carry over during the production of the movie and probably shoot themselves in the foot in the process.
Well, and that's what happened with Amazing Spider-Man 2. You know, it's like
more villains.
Well, there. My motto is: hasn't Schumacher taught us anything? You know, you look at the last Batman movie that Schumacher did, and it was like a cavalcade of every frickin' bat person you could possibly throw in there, and it bombed. And any other movie where they've gone, you know, let's just, you know, the answer here is more villains. So when you get to Tobey Maguire's Spider-Man 3, that was complete and utter crap because they should have focused on Sandman or Venom. But no, they had Sandman, Venom, and Harry's final chapter in there. It was just stupid. And then you watch Amazing Spider-Man 2, which we just checked out for the library, same thing. Rhino had no reason to be in that film. That was stupid.
And the funny thing is, from a narrative point of view, once you get into sequels, especially deep sequels like the third movie, the hero story's almost pretty much been told, unless you start doing like they did with Spider-Man, which from Sam Raimi, and start just retelling the same story and resetting thing with every sequel. The story you're telling, once you're done, like you're on the second or third iteration, you're telling the villain story. So you should be having fewer villains instead of more, and be going deeper into their motivation and their background. Instead of just like glossing over it, oh, he's evil and he's got powers. Let's go. And they always do that in reverse, and that's where it falls apart.
Well, I think going back to Brad's statement of too many cooks in the kitchen, or whoever said that, that's definitely what happened with the last Amazing Spider-Man, because it was Brian Michael Bendis gave them a whole bunch of suggestions, and they took one of his, the mechanical web shooters, and that was it. Like they pretty much, there's this, like, it was a council of executives from Sony making all the decisions for this movie. That's not the way you should do movies. You know, it shouldn't be a board. It shouldn't be a boardroom decision. That's for sure.
No.
All right. Well, hope.
When you look at movies, like everybody has, like there's all the. You look at the credits. Like everybody's got a very specific job. It should be pretty easy to determine who's doing what, and yet everything seems all over the place. Like directors take too much control. Some actors take too much control. Like everybody wants to be the movie. Just do your fucking job, people.
Okay, can somebody make a note of where JF said the F word?
I'm sorry. I apologize.
9:46 p.m.
I forgot.
Okay. 46 minutes in, I believe, is where we're at here. Hang on.
I forget.
Damn you.
It would be Dave's job to make the notes, since he's the one that's got to edit it.
Poor guy.
Of course my computer seizes up. Okay. Well, it's the other problem is my computer seizes up pretty much during when we do Hangouts. I can't do anything really on my computer, so it takes like 5 minutes for two things on the screen to appear from my keyboard. So
there. I typed it in 46 minutes.
Oh, well. Okay. Thank you very much. All right. Let's move on to our big question of the week. You guys ready to answer the big question of the week? Yes?
Sure.
Yes.
Maybe.
Okay. And it's the big one. And this is, as you can almost answer it with anything. Like, it depends on your opinion. So here we go. Big question of the week. What is your definition of sci-fi? And do you think science fiction is different than sci-fi? There's sci-fi, there's science fiction. Is there a difference between those two? Let's kind of go around the panel. Who wants to start?
Let's start with our guest first.
Definition of sci-fi. Yeah, Rodrigo.
Well,
this is
much. I'm
this,
in
this
the same
goes for me. For me at least, it goes back to my childhood because my not my childhood, but I had an uncle who was a little bit nuts. He used to say there's a difference between sci-fi and science fiction. Sci-fi is more like pop culture. Light things, like comic books or, you know, movies. And science fiction would be your novels or your serious thinking science fiction concepts. I guess that's the difference for me, at least.
Pop sci-fi.
Yeah. Yeah, like a Terry Pratchett book, I guess, would be science fiction. As opposed to, like, I don't know, Flash Gordon movie from 1979, I guess that would be sci-fi. That's the prime example, but...
The peasant.
Thank you.
I wrestle with this a lot because whenever I'm trying to make editorial decisions for the website and for the podcast, I have to figure out in my own head what is science fiction and what is not. You know, I don't consider Sharknado science fiction, but some people may, you know, think of it as science fiction, sci-fi.
Well, Sharknado would be more fantasy because, I mean, there's no real science behind it. It's just saying that, you know, these tornadoes come along and they suck up, well, I guess they're technically water spouts come along and they suck up these sharks and then they become tornadoes, thus the name Sharknado. To me, science fiction has to have some sort of technology, idea of a technology. Otherwise, it becomes fantasy.
Or science.
Fantasy implies, like, it implies explicit use of, like, magic or something fantastic. And as ridiculous as sharks and a tornado is, and probably not sci-fi, I think it's just straight-up fiction. Neither fantasy nor science fiction.
Now, if it's...
Actually, I'm thinking not a hybrid as much now, as neither of them.
If there was some sort of evil villain that he had created this machine that creates tornadoes or water spouts that goes and sucks up sharks and then goes to major coastal cities and attacks people, then that would be more of a science fiction, I would think.
Yes.
Yeah, kind
of. It all relies on a bunch of guys with hackers.
Crystals.
Well, it... Yeah, at the same time, though.
Yeah, it's techno babble. And actually, if you look at how I would define sci-fi, then yeah, Sharknado would definitely fit into science fiction. Not very serious or believable science fiction, but science fiction nonetheless.
Yeah, it would...
What?
I don't know. To me, it rings more on the side of fantasy, because, I mean, you can still have people try to explain stuff, but it doesn't necessarily have to be entirely, like, realistic, I guess. And with science fiction, at least a lot of people... A lot of authors and stuff try to think of potential concepts that could be real and creating, like, maybe there's these big technological advances, whether they find, like, some sort of ore or create some sort of computer code to create artificial intelligence. And, I mean, Star Trek has created so many things that... You know, we kind of thought that they were fantasy, and now we have similar technology.
Yeah, but as much as we want to give credit to Star Trek for having given us things that became real technology, they did come up with a bunch of things that we know is complete hokum.
Oh, yeah, and it doesn't necessarily have to become, like, an actual real thing. It's just, rather than having, you know, like, dragons and witches and magic, they at least have some sort of thought process, like, oh, here's this device that we've created that will be able to transform an aluminum can into a tree or something. Right, and that would be more of, it leans more towards fantasy to me than it does science fiction. I mean, it can be considered both, but yeah, if you're going to draw like a Venn diagram, then, you know, it's going to fall in the category of both.
It basically boils down to this narrative thing, and actually this is something I want to do a net bite on for Galactic Netcast, is this thing, in especially in fiction, called the conceit, which is essentially the basic rule, the thing that you ask your readers or viewers to accept blindly. And the nature of that conceit is what's going to determine whether you're sci-fi, fantasy, or sci-fi fantasy, or any of the subgenres of either. And basically, that conceit, if that conceit says, well, you have to accept that there are water spouts that can pick up large amount of sharks and toss them at people, and that is a scientific thing. If that's the conceit, then that's science fiction. It's clearly fiction because it's ridiculous, but it asks you to think of it as something that's science-based. The same way, it's the same way as for the trilithium crystal. It says, well, we have these crystals, and although like a lot of people will say that crystals is like just hokum and magic, in our universe, we ask you to believe that these crystals that have so much energy that we can make antimatter with them, they're real, and we can farm them and wear them as jewelry and use them as the engine in the engines of starships that go faster than light. That's our conceit. You have to accept that, and you have to think of it as science. Where Star Wars is interesting is that it asks you to have two conceits. One, that we have spaceships, and they're so advanced that you don't even need, like, you don't need complex takeoff procedures. You can just hop in them like they're your car and go to the other end of the galaxy. But at the same time, magic. So it's really how you establish, as long, I think science fiction is defined as something that has a conceit that asks for an advanced scientific belief and is internally consistent with it.
You know, I had a feeling that this was going to be a good topic of discussion.
Well, to me, though, like, science fiction and sci-fi are the same thing, though.
Yeah, I think one's the abbreviation for the other, but, I mean, language keeps evolving.
Yep. Rodrigo?
No, it's, I don't know. I guess there's certain things, there's certain criteria it has to have. Like, it has to have some kind of, well, I just look at it, you know, sci-fi, science fiction. So it's either got to have some kind of mechanical aspect to it, like technology. It's got to be in the future with, like, future technology of some kind. You know, I just look at the basic tenets of science fiction, you know, time travel, robots, space, which used to be a podcast on this network, by the way, time traveling robots. And if it's got too little of each thing, like if it's too much fantasy, I won't pick it as science fiction or sci-fi. If it's got too little, I don't know. I guess it's just kind of a fly by my seat of the pants kind of thing when it comes to deciding on what's science fiction or not. I don't know.
You go with your feeling.
Yeah, I think it depends on the day, too, or the week, as far as the amount of science fiction news. If it's a slow week, you know, maybe James Bond will make the cut. On a busy week?
And the other thing, too, is you also look at the environment. You know, if it's plausible that, you know, there's somebody on the moon and this thing happens, then, you know, you could probably classify it as sci-fi as well. It doesn't necessarily have to be on Earth and with technology, or in a spaceship with technology that's not even been created or even possible yet.
Like people, people described Gravity as science fiction or sci-fi. I don't know if it really is, because we are pretty much doing all of what is happening in that movie, right?
But, well, except for sending doctors up to space for no apparent reason.
But it is science fiction in the sense that it's science fiction based in science.
It does contain science.
It's definitely what one would call hard sci-fi, in the sense that it's trying to be as realistic as possible. But I mean, it does refer to a shuttle mission that never happened. There's a lot of conceits. Like, it asks you to believe that, yes, there is, like, you have to believe that someone can take one of those little jetpacks and move from the ISS to another satellite. It asks you to believe a lot of stuff that is technically impossible, but it tries to stay as grounded in reality as possible. So that makes it hard sci-fi.
The Martian would be considered hard sci-fi, because it's something that's plausible, takes place in the near future. It hasn't happened. We don't have any missions to Mars going on right now. But you've got this person trying to use every available resource that he has on the planet Mars to survive, and he's using science to explain what he's doing and why he's doing what he's doing. But in such a way that it's not, like, too heavy, because there are, quote, hard sci-fi books that'll basically spell out the entire scientific logic behind what's going on. And yeah, they get lost in the science more than the story.
Yeah, but there's a public for that, which is
great. There is a public for that. I am not that public.
I am on occasion, but a lot of stuff, like, flies over my head too. But it's fun to sort of challenge yourself with some of these books.
Yeah.
I think it's really just a call, a personal. What you think is science fiction, as long as it's not too outside of the bounds of what most people think is science fiction. To me, fiction is something that wouldn't necessarily happen now. Like, it's not possible for whatever the story revolves around to be happening in our real life, in our real world. That's, to me, that's science fiction. Twilight? No, we're not. No, we're not calling Twilight science fiction. No way. No how. Not.
It was just the definition you were giving was so generalized it could have been for fantasy
they
as well.
Sparkle.
That's part of my definition. Part of it.
But I tend to look at it like a spectrum, like a multidimensional spectrum, where your story can range somewhere between sci-fi and fantasy and tend more towards one than the other, and there's gradient between them. And then once you've established that sort of horizontal line, there's also a vertical line that kind of creates a gradient between how serious you want to be with your story. Do you want your science fiction to be really hardcore speculative, or do you want it to be more freeform and allow for more conceits? I'm going to use my own book as an example. Like, I try to ground a lot of the stuff that I wrote in my book on things that are possible, but not to the point that it's like I still put the narrative before the science. So there's a lot of stuff that probably, as time goes on, is going to prove to be more magical than scientific, just because the plausibility of these things ever happening is going to be denied. But at the same time, like I try to make it as speculative as possible. So there's different gradients, there's different subgenres, which makes it very complicated. I think in the future, especially with some of the more complex stories that we're seeing develop, and with more Star Wars on the way, we're going to see people not look at two definite genres as science fiction and fantasy, but more as degrees in how many ingredients, like, oh, a little science, a little fantasy, a lot of science fiction, touch of steampunk for aesthetics, and there you go. Like, there's going to be in a recipe.
Speculative fiction, right? That's a more general, overarching term for stuff like that, right?
Well, there's still some morality play in fantasy, but not like you're right that a lot of it has spilled into science fiction, and there are some people that will say that the best science fictions are the ones that question like how society and civilization works, and you know, shines a spotlight on our ethics and all that.
All right. I think we pretty much covered what we can cover on this. We could probably go on for hours debating. So maybe we'll do part two someday. Who knows? But thank you very much, guys. Everybody contributed equally, and I feel we covered it pretty well. All right, so we have the Geek Drink of the Week, and I wanted to pick this from something that we talked about earlier. It is the Spider-Man. And if you're interested in the Geek Drink of the Week, the Spider-Man contains... Spider-Man? The Spider-Man... Nick Spider-Man. The Spider-Man contains 1 ounce of cherry liqueur, 1 ounce of raspberry liqueur, 2 ounces of tequila, a 0.125 packet Pop Rocks. I don't know what... Okay, yeah. Wait, mixed cherry...
Pop Rocks are?
What?
Huh? You don't know what Pop Rocks are, Dave?
No, I know what Pop Rocks are.
Oh.
No, I was confused by the number. What quantity is 0.125? There's nothing.
0.125 ounces packet of Pop Rocks, I would imagine.
No, that's an eighth of a packet. It's probably like a pinch of Pop Rocks.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you don't want to put a whole bag of Pop Rocks into your drink.
Oh, you do.
Yeah, you do.
You get a face full of Spider-Man is what you get there.
Oh, yeah.
Boom.
Wow, okay. That's what Peter said to Mary Jane on their honeymoon.
In your face!
Okay, so you mix the cherry liqueur and tequila in an average-sized glass, add Pop Rocks, bam, there you go, that's your Spider-Man. So, yeah, if you're going to a party this weekend, you bring this recipe along and you introduce people to the Spider-Man, they'll thank you for it later. You got some Pop Rocks? I mean, every good bar has Pop Rocks, right? Right? That's the normal thing to have in your, behind your bar, right? Pop Rocks?
Duh. Right next to the limes.
Yes.
Pop Rocks in your face.
All right. So final piece of business. We've got some feedback this week. It comes from a former guest and former host, co-host of the Sci-Fi Geeks Club, Daryl Johnston from the UK. He has something to say about something that we talked about last week. So go ahead, Daryl.
It's Daryl here. Just listening to Sci-Fi Geeks Club. I'm sorry, but you have failed to do the great Christopher Lee justice. You briefly mentioned his time in World War II, Special Forces. He predates the SAS. Basically, he is the original SAS. Quite splendid, I'm sure you'll agree. Now, the thing that Brad was trying to recount, which is, well, he was asked by Peter Jackson on set if he could imagine what it's like to kill a man. And the story goes, he just raised his head and said, "What makes you think I have to imagine?" We lost a movie great. Matt should seriously listen to his music. It's not all too prog rocky. His Christmas carols are indeed the best thing that's ever been recorded. But yeah, we lost a great of the screen, and we should all watch Hammer House of Horror films. Anyway, that's enough of me. Catch you later, guys. Cheers.
All right, thanks, Daryl. And I saw my TV guide that Turner Classic Movies is going to be doing a Christopher Lee marathon, movie marathon this week.
Oh, cool.
And a heavy on the Hammer. Is that the Hammer House? Is that what they're called?
The Hammer horror films, yeah.
Yeah.
It's going to be, the marathon is going to be heavy on those films. So if you've never seen Christopher Lee in that role, well, check out Turner Classic Movies this week and or next week. Sometime next week, I think.
It's the only reason right. Why I sometimes wish I had cable.
Yeah, I know. But we cut the cord, and there are certain sacrifices you make when you do that. So.
You know, I was a cord cutter. I was a cord cutter till I got married and moved in with my wife and her daughter, and that's not a thing anymore. And I love cable. Cable is the best. And JF and I are going to be living in a country who is deregulating the cable industry. They are going to be offering, you're going to soon in Canada be able to get a la carte packages, which is going to be very interesting. And they're still working on details on that.
Back to cable if they do that, so I can stop having a ton of stupid. My problem is that living in Quebec, I bet we're going to have dumb rules that are going to force us to take French channels if we take English channels.
Yeah.
Because somehow that's going to force us to be more French, I think. I don't know.
You're not French enough.
I think the French-leaning Quebec government is trying to destroy French in Quebec by making everybody hate it.
Or maybe they're hoping you'll hear it so much that you'll be like, oh, I really dig French.
Nope.
I'm not sure what their logic would be. But
no, I like French. I mean, it's a beautiful language, Sarah, Sarah. And I would probably speak it more and use it more if it wasn't something that we get beaten over the head with
right.
all the time and feel strong-armed into using. How should I say? The best way to convert someone to your cause is to make them share your love for it. If you make them hate your cause, they're probably going to rebel. But that's
yeah,
a
very
yeah. different argument that's outside the scope of this podcast.
And you guys don't understand that in Ontario, things have to be in both French and English.
And
in
English,
Quebec,
yeah.
It just French. It's not a two-way street. At all.
It's a stupid way of doing things. Because what we should do as a country is just have everything be bilingual everywhere. Because I've heard something about knowledge being power, and knowing two languages in a world that's increasingly about communications is kind of a useful tool to have.
Mm-hmm.
So,
let's make
a subject that just makes me mad, and it's not something I want to talk about too long.
Let's compromise and make up a whole new language. How about that? Let's do that. Let's get on that.
Sure. We'll call it Esperanto, and no one will speak it ever.
All right. That's going to do it for this episode of the Sci-Fi Geeks Club. Rodrigo Lopez, thank you for being our guest this week. Where can people find your stuff, or where do you want to point people online for your stuff? Oh.
There's both. It's because you saw the movie.
Right.
Theme does exist. And there's no shame in that. Nice.
That's the best.
I love the name.
And everybody, well, you have to watch our video to see Rodrigo's epic beard. You just have to. So if you're just listening to the podcast, go to our YouTube channel, youtube.com/galacticnetcast, and check out Rodrigo's beard, because I'm in love with it.
I'm jealous. Nice.
Oh yeah.
So I have to go on YouTube to check this out, because I don't see it.
All right. Thanks everybody for joining us. And I'm Dave Nelson on behalf of Brad, Anessa, Matt, and Rodrigo, and JF. We'll talk to you guys next time.
Bye.
Bye, Dad.